Hello, everyone, and welcome to Collider Nightmares. I'm your host, Clarke Wolfe. I have my Krampus horns on. This is our holiday episode of the scariest show on Earth. Thank you so much for watching. We've got a big show for you guys today. But first, let's go ahead and introduce our panel. To my left is Miss Perri Nemiroff.
Oh, hi, guys. It is such a special episode because everything Clarke just said and because I feel really freaking old today. We will get to why very soon.
Yes, we will. We're all old indeed. And to her left is Mr. Jon Schnepp.
Why, hello there, children. I believe I'm the oldest one on this very special Christmas episode of Collider Nightmares.
Thank you, old man Schnepp. And to my right, we have a very special guest, Mr. Steve Zaragoza, everybody.
Yay! Yay! I'm the second oldest. I don't have arthritis yet.
Oh, wait till you get it. It's very painful and delicious.
I can't wait.
Oh, good. This is off to a great and crumbly start.
Yeah.
Steve, I'm so glad you could make it today. We've been wanting to have you on for such a long time.
Yes, and I get jealous every time I see you do this because it's such a cool, fun show, and I've always wanted to be a part of it, so thank you for having
me. Well, thank you so much for spreading the holiday cheer with us.
Of course, of course.
So let's go ahead and get into our fresh meat.
Fresh meat.
Squish, squish, squish.
Yummy.
So first things first, a few months back, Nightmare shared with you the news that Captain America himself, Chris Evans, would take on the role of a modern-day Henry Jekyll in a character named Tom Jackman. The Lionsgate project is based on the BBC series called Jekyll from 2007. Now, Deadline is reporting that Zombieland director Ruben Fleischer is attached to helm the project. And while Universal revealed their first look at Russell Crowe's Henry Jekyll in the first trailer for Alex Kurtzman's The Mummy, Evans and Fleischer's feature is a loose take on the Robert Louis Stevenson tale. According to Deadline, Anthony Baragozzi and Charles Mondry have written the script based on the Stephen Moffat scripted six-episode miniseries. Bagarossi and Mondry teamed up on the Shane Black-directed The Nice Guys and Doc Savage as well as the remake of Death Note. So, because my explanation might not have been very clear, sorry about that. This is a feature film adaptation of a miniseries from the BBC called Jekyll. It is almost a sequel, as that's kind of how the Stephen Moffat and the creators have explained it. They consider it like a continuation of the story. So the character that Chris Evans will be playing is, once again, he's called Tom Jackman. And Schnepp, I know you've seen this BBC miniseries. Mm-hmm. So now, we told you Chris Evans was involved back in the summer. We know that. But now Ruben Fleischer from Zombieland is attached. So having known the series and now knowing the screenwriters are the guys who brought you the other guys and worked on Adam Wingard's Death Note, what are you thinking? Does it sound like it's all coming together?
It sounds really exciting. If you haven't checked out Jekyll, I say do it. It's great. I think it's five or six episodes. It stars Tom Nesbitt, I believe his name is, and Michelle Ryan, and it's fantastic. It's a spin on the modern, it takes a modern look at the Jekyll and Hyde tale, but does this really kind of really inventive and crazy take on it, and every episode gets a little weirder and a little weirder. So I can't wait. I think it's a perfect vehicle for Evans as well. So to hear that maybe it's not a direct remake, but there's like an element of a sequel part, but they have to reintroduce a lot of elements, I'm really excited that they're doing this.
Well, and I love what you just said about Chris Evans, because it's true. I mean, I think he's a really talented actor, but most of us mostly know him as Captain America.
Right.
And he hasn't had a chance to really stretch. So, Perri, is this the type of role that you want to see Chris Evans in? And additionally, the idea that Ruben Fleischer is behind the camera, is that something that you think is a good combination?
I'm so glad you pitched this discussion to me that way, because the reason I'm excited about it and still excited about it is strictly because of Chris Evans. Everyone out there knows at this point, I like things nice and neat and organized. So when I hear dueling projects, I just don't like it because it's messy and I can't picture two people in the same role. It's just stupid things in my head. But I think this is a great opportunity for Chris Evans that he really needs to have, because yes, we've seen him as Captain America. I've seen a couple other performances of his where he's great. I'm trying to think of one now.
Snowpiercer.
Well, Snowpiercer.
Oh, yeah.
Snowpiercer,
yeah.
To me is a good example to compare with Captain America, where look at those two performances and that guy's got range. He's got real nuance to him. And there's another movie that now is escaping me that I saw Tribeca a while back that he was great in. But I want to see him have some room to breathe. And this is the kind of character that you get to do that. In terms of Ruben Fleischer, I am one of the biggest Zombieland fans out there. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite movies. I'll drop anything to watch that. I watch it often. And I've been rooting for the sequel, which... have we gotten an update on that? I don't think that's gotten anywhere.
It's never going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, and then they had that failed TV show. Yeah.
Right. Well, just to interject, because the piece that, you know, broke the story about Ruben Fleischer signing on to direct this film noted that he is allegedly supposed to get into production on Zombieland 2, but what's happened is since Zombieland, Emma Stone... heard of her. Exactly. Emma Stone.
Might be a little busy.
Right. Woody Harrelson, a little busy. And Mark Zuckerberg. Jesse Eisenberg.
All
Very
of
busy.
Them, really. Abigail Breslin, too.
Exactly.
I mean, she's doing blown more up. And more. But, you know, I like him as a director with that movie. But after that, you know, 30 minutes or less was fine. And then Gangster Squad was forgettable. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he's got that one that I'm going to love. I hope he can bring that same kind of, you know, really unique style. And he had a really firm handle on that kind of material. Obviously, I think this would be a very different tone. But I have hopes for him as a director, even though his last two disappointed me a little.
Well, and Steve, I wanted to bring up, you know, Perri just brought up a great point of dueling Dr. Jekylls, essentially. So Russell Crowe, I mean, a heavyweight by all standards in terms of, like, the acting game, and he's going to be blasting off as Dr. Jekyll in the Mummy movie.
Yeah.
And now we have this sort of, like, continuation of the story coming out of Lionsgate. Do you think that that's going to, one's going to really affect the other, or are they just such different takes that it might not matter?
I feel like they've done this before, haven't they? Haven't there been, like, dueling, like, Universal monster movies or something?
Sure.
Or, like, I feel like, I don't know, maybe aside from it being confusing to audiences, it maybe won't do much to ticket sales. But I don't know. I mean, Universal hasn't had much of a great track record with their monster revival movies.
Right.
So I don't know. I mean, if Moffat's attached in some way to this other Jekyll thing, is he? Did you say at all?
He didn't write the script for the Jekyll feature coming out of Lionsgate, but this is very much based on his original property.
Well, I feel like that's enough to kind of get, like, at least the nerdier audience, the Doctor Who fans going like, ooh, a movie that Moffat's involved in? Let's check this out.
And let me add a correction. It's James Nesbitt, not Tom Nesbitt.
And did you see why I recognized him? Did you see what else he was in?
No.
He was in the Hobbit movies. He was the Hobbit with the big funny hat.
Makes
That's
sense
where
now.
I've seen that guy. They gotta put him in.
I was
the
gonna
movie.
Add though, I mean, one of the cool things about this Jekyll version is that when Nesbitt turns into from Jekyll to Hyde, it's more of an actor's transformation. It's not fit makeup. So when you see check out the BBC version, I hope they maintain that because that will really be a great thing for Chris Evans to be playing both Jekyll and then the transformation of Hyde just in acting alone.
And I'm sure they don't want to gross up Chris Evans with, like, prosthetics or something, right? I feel like people would, like, pick at that.
They'd be,
like, don't put prosthetics on that handsome
He just grossed one giant forehead boil. I'm Hyde now.
Well, yeah. He's disgusting.
No, that's like when Gerard Butler was the Phantom of the Opera, and he was like, his mask was like an eye patch, and he was like, oh, I'm hideous. Oh, why doesn't anybody? I was like, you're Gerard Butler, and I would still make out with you.
I wonder
even
if there was
the
something
Phantom.
In his contract where it was like, you can't make me look ugly at all.
Yeah.
Like, I've got to be that pretty boy.
That's what happens when Hollywood can't be handsome anymore.
Right. Yeah. I almost wonder if they're going to do the complete opposite.
Well, we'll find out, I suppose. It's coming soon. And hopefully, I'm really excited. I like Ruben Fleischer for this. I like this previous scripts that the screenwriters have done as well, because I feel like it shows that they have a sense of humor, a sense of dark humor. And I think Fleischer has a really dark sense of humor as well. So, and Chris Evans, for that matter, I think has a great sense of humor. So I think it's a good combination, but we'll keep our fingers crossed. So moving on to something that we'll probably see a little bit sooner. Coming Halloween 2017 is the latest installment of the Insidious franchise, subtitled Chapter 4. Lin Shaye, who plays Elise in all of the previous three movies, has given a preview of what fans can expect from the fourth movie. Said Shaye, it's a fantastic story, and it took me back into what made Elise who she is. You meet my family, my mother, my father. We go back to my hometown, which is in New Mexico. And so that's where this takes place, and her quest to find the bad guy that's been haunting her. It's a really wonderful story. I think fans will really, really start enjoying it, or will be really enjoying it. And it's scary on levels they're not going to expect. Mm. Insidious Chapter 4, starring Lin Shaye, Lee Winnell, Angus Simpson, is directed by the taking of Deborah Logan's Adam Robitaille and hits theaters on October 20th, 2017. Okay, so Perri, I want to start with you because you are not the biggest fan of Insidious Chapter 3, mm-hmm. which I think is the general consensus for most people. However, does the premise of a Lin Shaye origin story sort of get you, and the combination of that and the taking of Deborah Logan's mm-hmm. Adam Robitaille, does that get you excited at all? Do you think there's hope for the franchise?
Yes. This is what I wanted from Insidious Chapter 3.
I agree.
Like the second we got Insidious Chapter 2 and everybody, you know what happens? Everyone's on the internet saying this is going to be the plot. What could it be? And asking Lee Winnell a million questions. This was the idea that I wanted, and I think this has so much potential. It is very difficult to shake off the disappointment that was Insidious Chapter 3 because I am a huge fan of this franchise. I adore the first movie. I love the second movie. Not as much as the first, but I still love it. And I was just covering the crap out of Insidious Chapter 3. We went to a really cool event in Miami where we got to talk to Lee and go in this little experience thing. I was just like living and breathing Insidious Chapter 3. I walked into that movie with such high expectations.
Oh, man.
It broke my heart. It was probably one of the biggest disappointments. I was just so bummed. But I'm still a franchise fan, and I'm going to get behind this. I like the group that's working on it. I love Lin Shaye. I think she can do no wrong in anything she's in, pretty much. So this is the idea I wanted. I was reading a little more, and it was saying her quest to find the bad guy that's been haunting her, that intrigues me, just because, you know, she's the ghost hunter in a way. She's the person who helps people rid themselves of whatever's going after them. So I'm curious to see, you know, is that something she picked up from one of her clients? Is it something personal that, you know, led her to all this? I don't know. I'm looking forward to getting her backstory and learning about the people that are around her.
And Steve, you know, I know that you are a fan of the first two movies
yeah.
as well. You know, the thing that's so interesting to me as a horror fan is the fact that a major horror franchise is based around a 70-year-old woman,
right.
which is just like kind of incredible considering. Yeah. I don't think anything else can say the same in this day and age, and that is simultaneously really depressing, but also kind of amazing about the Insidious franchise.
Yeah.
So my question for you is, you know, even after skipping the third movie, do you think that you could, as a fan, potentially get involved and get excited about her backstory?
Yeah, I'm just concerned about this because this is how many years after the third one, or
only
before
like
the
one
third
or
one does this take place?
Well,
is it like a prequel to the third one?
No.
Or?
So what's going to happen, the chronology is Insidious Chapter 3, and then Insidious Chapter 4 essentially picks up
okay, got it.
It's before the Rose Byrne and Patrick Wilson case.
Right, yeah. So I'm just hoping they don't do any more weird dubbing like they did in the second one, like in the beginning with her.
Yeah.
Because I remember, I totally forgot about it until you mentioned it. And I was like, that was the most distracting thing about it.
Right, yeah. It was her voice, but a young actress.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember
yeah,
not liking
she
that
She has
part
such a distinct
voice. It's such a distinctive voice. Yeah, yeah. It's just like, that's a little weird, but I guess it kind of worked. I mean, I'm on board. I think the series is fun. I kind of like the kind of disjointed poltergeist ghost hunter kind of like house cleaner thing that they've kind of kept throughout the series. And again, I mean, I'll check out the third one even if it's real bad news, but I like to complete my horror movies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want to just like skip one. I don't think I've ever done that, like where you kind of just don't watch the third one and then just go straight to the fourth one. But you were saying that it's kind of like it doesn't matter if you didn't see the third one, right?
I would say, I mean, we haven't seen the fourth movie yet, so we don't know, but I would assume that it's safe to say, look at the third movie as like a standalone.
Yeah.
Did you have something you want to add?
No, I guess I look at the third movie as separate from the first two, but based on the synopsis, it sounds like you kind of might need that as a little, like a gateway to four. Mm. But I don't know. It doesn't sound
Hopefully
reliant on it
do,
either.
Like a previously on Insidious, like when it starts.
Right. We're like, if you missed the third one because it sucked balls, here's a quick recap.
Yeah. Did you see the third one, Shep?
I most definitely did not. After Perri's crushing soul destroyed,
like,
I don't
want
to see it.
Yeah,
unless
watch
I'm going to watch it with everybody. I was like, let's have a special Insidious 3, get drunk, watch Screen Fest, then see the fourth one. Maybe we could do that.
Okay, I would do that.
Like, Lin Shaye to me, is forever going to be in Kingpin, one of my favorite
movies.
I know,
movies. And you can't unsee.
You can't unsee
the,
that.
The,
yeah.
The, like the tongue and the yeah. Head. Yeah, you just
yeah. If you don't know what we're talking about, check out Kingpin yeah, and then Kingpin. Get back to us. But Insidious 1 and 2, I liked Insidious 2 a little bit better because it went really, really went there. It went crazy. Patrick Wilson's amazing in it. Everyone in it is really fun. I didn't really like Insidious 1. I mean, I liked the first hour, and I remember it gave me one of the biggest jump scares I've had in a movie. I think it was with a little kid when he was, like, freaking out or whatever. I was like, what the hell? But then with that demon, the doll demon, I'm red-faced pumpkin head or whatever.
The Darth Maul thing.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And then they're fighting in slow motion in, like, yeah. Freddy's crypt. I was like, boo. So, but the Insidious 2 got really weird with the further and all the creepy ghosts, so... I never saw the third one, but I'm in. I want to see this. I might have to see the third one.
Yeah, maybe just watch it. Yeah. I'm going to watch the third one.
We'll watch
you guys
it
can
you.
Watch it together.
Yeah, let's watch
exactly.
It together.
Exactly.
And force Perri and Clarke to watch it with
us. My soul was not crushed like Perry's was. I don't love Insidious Chapter 3, but I think it has some good ideas in it, and that's what I'll say. So, I mean, it's not the for me, it wasn't the worst thing I've ever seen. Real fast, I want to ask the panel, has anyone on the panel seen The Taking of Deborah Logan?
Nope.
At all? Oh, man, I'm the only one. Okay, add Cody. Thanks, Cody. Cody, do you give it thumbs up? Yeah, Cody gives it
thumbs up from young Tom Holland himself.
from Spider-Man himself. So just for you guys out there, you know, because I do think what was cool about Insidious Chapter 3 was that it was Lee Winnell's directorial debut. And with Insidious Chapter 4, they have Adam Robitaille, who directed The Taking of Deborah Logan. And this one was a little sleeper movie that just kind of came and went. And I think it might have only had a direct-to-VOD release. But it's a really cool... You know, the reason I can give it such high praise, in addition to being a good movie, is that it came around at a time when I was so burned out by found footage that I was like, do not show me another found footage movie. I don't care.
Yeah.
I'm not watching it. It's kind of like with Train to Busan and zombies. Mm. I was like, no more zombies.
Right.
I don't care. And then I watched Train to Busan and I was like, wow, this is amazing. And with found footage, I watched The Taking of Deborah Logan. It is framed as a documentary, but like a true documentary about a woman who's suffering from Alzheimer's. But then you wonder, oh, but is it really Alzheimer's? Is she really an Alzheimer's patient? Or is there demonic possession at work? So this was Adam's film. I think, you know, look, I think it's really worth a watch. Last I checked, it was streaming on Netflix. So if you are curious and you're ready to get in the mood for and do your homework for Insidious Chapter 4, definitely check out The Taking of Deborah Logan.
I'm writing down so many suggestions for things right now. I'm totally taking notes.
I love it. Good, good. I like to hear that. All right, well, let's move on because as we've discussed in previous episodes, I like weird stuff. Do you like weird stuff? Do you guys like weird stuff?
I do.
I think we're all on board with weird stuff.
Just a little bit.
And director Gore Verbinski has given us some pretty weird stuff in the past.
Oh, yeah.
So while his latest A Cure for Wellness has been light on plot details, the first trailer was filled with bizarre imagery. And now an international trailer has hit the web. And while not great in length, it is anything but short on disturbing and stylized images from the film. Dane DeHaan, Jason Isaacs, and Mia Goth star in A Cure for Wellness, which is out stateside on Friday, February 17th. Happy Valentine's Day. Get your weird tooth things on.
Take your loved ones and do the saltines challenge.
Right? And stick her in stick your lady in a bath full of eels. The most romantic thing you can imagine. So, Steve, I want to start with you.
Sure.
You know, this is a short little, I think it's out of South Korea, Korean trailer, but it's so distinctly Verbinski in a way, and these images are so bizarre that honestly, I don't even care what the plot is.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like I'm just signed up.
Well, I saw the trailer before. I forgot what I saw, but I saw a full, like, international, or maybe just the American
trailer,
and I was just like, it kind of looks like, you know, that Leo DiCaprio, like, funny house movie where he goes, what's that movie where he goes to the whack house?
Shutter Island.
Yeah, Island. It kind of looked like a Shutter Island meets The Cell kind of thing, which really, I mean, I don't know, I guess that's not such a bad thing, but I didn't get much from that trailer, but this trailer, I was like, oh yeah, okay, this is weird, it's creepy, it's gross, it's like bizarre. I'm all about it. If the movie is like a little bit like that, then I am so on board with it, for sure.
And Perri, you know, Gore Verbinski has done some really high-profile, mainstream things in the last handful of years. Lots of Pirates of the Caribbean, Indian activities and the Lone Ranger activities, yeah. which maybe don't leave the best taste right. in people's mouths. However, I got to give him big ups for The Weatherman, not a genre
oh, yeah.
film, but
yeah,
I
yeah.
love that movie. And also the American version of The Ring, which, gosh,
sure.
is
yep.
fabulous. So I wanted to ask you, you know, based on we've seen the first trailer, but now this other weird little thing, is your interest peaked?
Oh, I've been sold since the second that I saw that first trailer. I loved that trailer. I loved the idea of, obviously, with the tone of the trailer, it tells you this is bad stuff going on in this facility. And as it progresses, it shoves that in your face even more. But at the beginning, there is that feeling like, oh, I could see why people would do that. Then you look at it again through this lens. Oh, he's missing one.
Yeah,
I
just,
you
so
know how I
gross.
Feel about teeth. It freaks me out. And
awesome.
I mean, what a smart, short, sweet little piece of marketing, because it gets you staring at that bathtub, and then you see the creepy stuff in the bathtub,
gross.
And then you
around.
Then you think, all right, it's done. It's like one of the, but no, then it's the quick cutting thing, and it's, you know, that imagery. It's weird how quick all of those images come at you, and yet I can remember,
you retain all
I think
of them.
I remember
yeah.
all of them, and that's without clicking stop, stop, mm-hmm. stop, but then obviously I went back and did click stop, stop, because I have to mess with my head. I can't stare at that, but I made myself stare at it, because this stuff is freaky. I can't wait. And I keep hearing good things out of the Fox footage presentations where people seem to really like whatever they screen there. So I got sky-high hopes. I want this thing to give me tooth nightmares.
Yeah.
Well, so, Schnepp, I wanted to ask, you know, with the American version of The Ring specifically, one of the things that this little trailer reminded me of was the actual video that you watch in The Ring.
Sure.
I mean, it's all that
yeah.
stylized, yeah. muted tones kind of, and really effed up imagery. Did you have any strong reactions to this one?
Yeah, I did. You know, watching the trailer made me really bummed out that he's not making BioShock.
Oh,
I honestly was like, man, there's like, I bet some of his visuals, because I know he worked on it for a while,
yep.
some of those visuals he kept with him. And he's like, I'm going to make that, you know, screw those people who didn't let me make BioShock. And they worked their way into this, because there's definitely a feeling of that, like that I get from, because I've played BioShock and BioShock 2 and BioShock Infinite. And now I'm going to play the meaning of what are the cure for wellness. I'm going to visually play it when I watch this movie. And I'm wearing that for Halloween. That's going to be my Halloween costume.
It's so awesome.
For about 38
How
seconds.
Are you eat
I know.
Candy in that?
I know.
Oh,
I don't
no.
think I'm going to do it. If I was, it'll have to have mandible talking. No, it's not like it's, I can talk through this. But yeah, it looks like a nightmare. And I cannot wait to see it. It looks incredibly visual. I don't know what the hell the story is, but I'm going to go. So.
Yeah. I think there's something to be said for just kind of not having to have it be, I don't know, we haven't seen the movie yet, so the story could be amazing. But honestly, even if it's not, I don't care.
Right.
I want to see it. I want to consume this. So February 17th, happy Valentine's
Yay!
Day.
Yay!
And moving on. So earlier this year, Nightmares told you about The Babysitter, what was then being called a horror comedy directed by McG. And after completing production for New Line Cinema, this week we learned that due to a crowded slate on New Line's part, the movie has been sold to Netflix. Starring Bella Thorne and Robbie Amell, The Babysitter follows a lonely 12-year-old boy who falls in love with his hot babysitter only to discover that she's part of a satanic cult that
Whoops.
Wants to kill him.
Yes.
Uh-oh. All right, so Schnepp, let's start with you. Now, I think, you know, regardless of what we think about, you know, we didn't break the news, but we talked about the news about McG and the fact that this was a script that was, there was a huge bidding war for, like, everybody wanted to make this movie, and so McG directed it, and now it's done. What do you think about the move to Netflix, and do you think that more people might see it now, considering, gosh, I mean, we were talking about it a few weeks ago, 2017, it's like there's not a single weekend that there's not a million things coming out.
I think it's a really smart move. I mean, how old's the kid again? He's like
12.
12. Eesh. I don't know what's going to be going on in the movie. You know, but, you know, he's got the hots for the babysitter, and there's some kind of weird cult activity. Probably not good things are happening to that 12-year-old and his family, but now we're going to get to experience at our house on Netflix land. So, you know, I think I love the advent of streaming television.
Yeah.
I think it's actually changed every single aspect of the way we consume products, media, the way we absorb every single piece of news,
to our shows, to binge watching, to I'm going to wait, like, which is going to come up later. We're going to discuss that. We couldn't have talked about that 5 years ago.
Right.
Even some of the things we're like, we're just, going to wait. I'll watch all 12 of them on Sunday. You couldn't have done that.
No.
There's no possible way. So I think it's a smart move where the theaters are getting crowded, and they are being crowded by $100 million blockbuster epics. And they're like planting flags all the way to 2020. We're like, we're staking out this date all the way into the future. So when you have smaller independent films, especially horror films, mm-hmm. I think it's a smart move to move to streaming services. Netflix, go to Shudder, go to wherever you can to get spotlighted and to get highlighted, because Netflix is going to be like, check out what's premiering this weekend. They're going to give it a boost to the millions and millions and millions of people who are already mm-hmm. subscribers who will watch that, as opposed to, oh, I've got to get on the code, and are we going to go to dinner and buy tickets to this? Or then, you know, to have those choices when you go to a movie theater, or you have those choices when you're at home, I think it's an obvious choice. I think it's a very smart move.
Yeah, the strategy behind it, like I was saying in our pre-production meeting, that I feel really strongly, this is not related, but it kind of is, that Popstar, which was the Lonely Island movie, would have been the biggest comedy of the summer if it had premiered on Netflix.
Wow, you're right.
And it's such a bummer to me that more people didn't see something like Popstar, because, okay, they didn't like the marketing, or they missed it because it came out in June and there was a Captain America movie or whatever, yep. right? So my point is, maybe something like this is the perfect place for a movie like this. Perri?
I'm glad you brought up Popstar.
I love Popstar. Go watch Popstar.
Not to make this a Popstar show when we're talking about nightmares, but that was such a great movie. I caught it late for that reason, and I'm glad I finally watched it, because it's really freaking funny. I also think, given the cast of this, you know, kids nowadays, they like their Netflix, and they don't want to go to the movie theater. You got Bella Thorne, Robbie Amell. I have a feeling this is going to appeal to the audience who would much rather just sit at home and put on a Netflix movie. But the only thing that has me not getting so hyped about this is McG.
Yeah.
I don't want to judge him. And, you know, people turn out duds every once in a while, and then they'll come back and make a great movie. So I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. However, you know how I feel about This Means War,
and that is
stuck in the back of my mind. However, one person in this cast that I'm really excited about is Judah Lewis, the kid from Demolition. Mm-hmm. I didn't love the movie Demolition. He is excellent in it. Actually, all the performances are excellent in that movie. It's just other things in the movie didn't work. But Judah Lewis, I think, is someone to keep an eye out for. So I'm assuming he's playing this 12-year-old boy. I think he's like 15 or 16 now, but when they shot it, maybe he looked young enough. But I love the premise. I'm excited to see him in it. I like the idea of this going to Netflix, and the fact that there's a major bidding war for this thing probably means it's a quality piece. So I'm excited. Come on, McG, prove me wrong.
Prove her wrong. I love McG. I don't care. I love him. He's also a really sweet dude.
Well, what was the last, like, good movie he made?
This Means War. Thank you.
Well, look, I didn't see This Means War.
No. I didn't either.
I liked his Charlie's Angels film.
Great.
Okay, there you go.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, look, I mean,
yes.
You know, he's the guy who calls himself McG, and he made a Charlie's Angels film. They match. They go together. They were fun.
By the way, if I could just interject real fast, I don't mean to cut you off, Steve, but we talked about this when we sort of announced, they announced that he was going to do this. This sounds like a premise that fits his sensibilities. It's suburban. Mm-hmm. It's poppy. It's allegedly a horror comedy. I mean, mm-hmm. I think this could really play to his strengths.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I just, it does sound pretty cool. I mean, it's the kind of premise where if you didn't know who was directing it, you'd be on board no matter what, I feel like. But I feel like there's still, to what you said, Schnapp, I think there's something to be said about kind of like the theater experience of seeing a movie like this. Like, it seems like this might be a squirmy kind of movie. I mean, especially when you've got such a young kid dealing with like kind of potential tones of sexuality, or, you know, like predatory kind of child predatory things. Mm-hmm. You know, there's something to be said about making people squirm in a movie theater where you're kind of trapped there. And watching it at home is really more comfortable. And obviously, I mean, I would prefer to stay at home and watch mm-hmm. a movie, and especially if it's included in my subscription. Mm-hmm. That you know, here's just a brand new cool horror movie that you already paid for that's just available. And I think that's great. But I mean, part of me is like, maybe if it's so cool and fun and good, why not have like a little limited theatrical run?
Sure.
You know, right. Why not? Mm-hmm.
Good point. Maybe there'll be some midnight screenings.
Right?
I'd be down. Yeah.
That makes sense.
Get on that, Netflix.
Yeah, Netflix. Where you at?
All right. So from one cult to another, this week we learned that Blade and the upcoming Leatherface star Steven Dorff will appear in a movie called Jackals, an 80s-set psychological thriller that centers on an estranged family who hire a deprogrammer, played by Dorff, to get back their teenage son from a murderous cult. But they find themselves under siege when the cultists surround their cabin demanding their boy back. Saw 6 and Saw 3D director Kevin Grutert directs a script from my buddy, Earbud Theater scribe, Are You Sleeping? He wrote Are You Sleeping, which was the thing we talked about earlier on Nightmares, the little audio drama I did. Jared Rivet. So yay, Jared. Mm. Congratulations. I'm talking way too much. Jackals co-stars Jonathan Schaech, who is on a bit of a horror kick lately, appearing in the Day of the Dead remake as Max, which is a new take on the iconic Bub Zombie, and is in pre-production on a new interpretation of Reanimator, for which he also received co-writer credit. So this is exciting and cool and weird. I don't know. I really like the premise of a cult film that's home invasion set in the 80s.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of weird. Perri, where are you on this?
There's a lot of key words in here that excite me, and it makes me think that not necessarily a genre mashup, but taking things like that and mixing things that normally aren't together. I mean, I like the 80s setting. I like the idea of a psychological thriller about a cult deprogrammer.
Yes.
That is really cool to me. And then it also feels like a home invasion. I think those are just the perfect pieces to what could be an excellent movie here. I don't know if you've ever seen Faults. It played at South by 2 years ago, but that's a movie about, you know, a cult specialist. And I just love that approach to it and how, you know, it doesn't have to be like, you know, slash and bloody horror, but just the whole mentality. I mean, it goes to the psychological thriller element of it, the whole mentality of a cult, and how you could just mash those two up make me really happy. And, you know, I like me some Steven Dorff. That's
right?
Fine by me.
All right, Steve, how about you?
I'm an old man, and I grew up in the 80s, and when you have, like, some 80s revival kind of, like, genre movie, I'm in. Like, Stranger Things really got me. I mean, it tugged on my 80s strings a little bit. So if you've got, like, an 80s style kind of, like, you know, Assault on Precinct 13, but with cult people, like, I'm in, baby. I'm in.
All right, Schnepp.
So I'm in. I love the description. But when I see this poster, you know what I see?
What do
you
see?
Name the movie.
Oh, you're next.
Exactly. And that pisses me off. That's not what the description is. So
your next can't claim all animal masks.
I'm just saying, it can't actually claim that poster because that's
and
a ripoff.
They're jackals.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say.
All right. I'm just saying, like, that's just too, and it's like the strangers. There's little elements that are like, okay. I love the premise, I love the way it's described. But then the movie better not be like, that's just the first 5 minutes, and then the other 90 minutes is in a cabin with these people with weird masks.
With the animal
on.
Masks looking through windows.
Yeah,
and shit.
Like,
yeah,
I just
kind of sick of that.
That's the one thing I'm like, I'm hoping it's not. So if it's not that, and it is what it's saying, the premise is, I'm 100% in. Mm-hmm. If it's there in a cabin for 90 minutes with little creepy people running around with masks, give our boy
and
back.
Giggling and
shit.
Yeah, I'm done.
Get it. Yeah.
Done.
Cancel.
You know what I see when I look at this poster?
What?
A lady leading the charge,
holding
an axe, which I think is really cool.
You know what else is cool? That tagline, because it's like family matters, like your cult family and your family, and the fact that they call it a psychological thriller makes me really think that what you're worried about won't happen.
I hope so, because I'm excited about the premise. So
I also like swings, and there's a swing in there, and I'm
Oh, it's outside. Yeah. I love being outside.
Break apart this poster.
Can I just say about the swing? I like the swing. Where my ass is grabbed by it. That's a ass grabber.
That is an ass
that's
grabber.
That's a, like, cinch sucker.
But it's a classic.
It is.
I mean, that's
it is.
It's
I just like the solid base where my ass can flatly sit while I'm swinging freely and not the cinch sucker ass grabber that is on
you know
it.
What's worse than the ass grabber off topic? The one that's like a little baby,
yeah,
like,
gotta
pants?
Yeah, you got to stick your legs.
I don't even fit.
I
would just be able to put one half leg in there and, like, fall on the ground crying.
What show is this again? What are you talking about?
Nightmare.
Welcome to Swing Sets. We talk about all swing sets.
We review
biggest swing sets on this show.
Sponsored by Home Depot. All right. Well, I think that's going to wrap it up for Jackals. We will definitely keep you posted as to when the movie will come out. And I'm sure Jared will come on at some point. And now let's go ahead and move on to our Monster of the Week.
Ooh.
Ah, scary. So this week celebrates, or yes, this week celebrates the 20-year anniversary of Scream, you guys.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Now, Scream was obviously a seminal horror movie that really changed the game, directed by Wes Craven and written by newcomer at that point, Kevin Williamson. You know, this is a movie that reinvigorated Wes's career. It gave Kevin Williamson his career, which is still going strong. And it relaunched slasher movies. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think the importance of Scream can be underappreciated. And so we just wanted to take a couple of minutes, meaning Perri's going to talk and we're all going to... No, I'm just kidding. But wanted to take a couple of minutes and remember this movie and talk about the legacy. So Perri, since I know this is your fave, let's go ahead and start with you.
Every single time I looked in Schnepp's direction, my head would like linger just to look at that screen a little more. Every single time I see Ghostface, I stop and I look. So whenever any of the Scream movies are on, everything comes to a pause so I can sit and watch. This movie is really special to me, not just because, as we brought up last week, because we were talking about gateway mm-hmm. horror movies. I mean, Scream was not the first horror movie I saw by any means, but I call it a gateway horror movie because it turned me into a horror fanatic where I needed everything. And this is what made me, like, horror fan above all other genres. I have seen Scream more times than I can count. My cat is named Dewey, as in Deputy Dewey, and I love him to death. I own a prop from Scream 4 because I thought, you know, because Dewey is named Dewey, I needed to own Deputy Dewey's name tag. I just couldn't be a bigger cheerleader for this movie. It's fun. It's scary. I was recalling that story where my mom took me to see it, mm-hmm. and just the two of us watching that opening scene together, I couldn't believe what I was watching, and in the best possible way, this is my movie. This and Jurassic Park are my two all-time favorite movies. I can't even. I just get so overwhelmed when I think about how excited this movie makes me.
Yeah, it's truly a new classic, and I don't say that lightly. We have a little special guest to join us. We have Mr. Mark Riley.
Oh, my God.
Oh, boy.
Oh, hi, everybody. Riley. I have morphed from Schnepp to Riley, and I've brought with me an ugly but great Lee Time Christmas sweater. Oh, and by the way, thank you, Clarke.
You're
Wolfe.
Welcome. You are welcome.
My Christmas
Mondo.
Gift.
Yes,
oh, I'm happy to jump in for a minute on Scream because I echo your sentiments, Perri. It is a movie that reinvigorated my love for the genre because I dropped off for a little bit. I'm not going to lie. There was some horror movies I don't even remember were coming out or were landing in theaters that stuck with me. And then Scream came out. And I'll always remember going to the theater with all my college buddies. I'm also dating myself. I'm very old. Mm-hmm. And seeing this movie and going, oh, my God, this is brilliant. This is everything a horror lover who grew up on the Friday the 13th, Halloween's, and Nightmare on Elm Street. I mean, he's quizzing Drew Barrymore at the beginning of the movie with my love of these movies. So to look out from the movie to the love of the genre that Kevin Williamson did, that just hit me. And then to get a scary movie so smartly written, it launched Kevin Williamson. As you said, they tried to redo, and they did. He wrote Halloween H2O after it because they're like, this guy knows his stuff, and gave us a great Halloween movie. I do enjoy that movie. But this has stuck with me. I own it. I would love posters on the wall. It's something that is, we've had four movies all together. We have the Scream series. It's stuck in the consciousness. It's become, Ghostface is right up there with Freddy and Jason and Michael Myers. And I you just cannot have this movie be not whispered in the same greatness as A Nightmare on Elm Street. Thank you, Wes Craven, or a Friday the 13th, or mm-hmm. some of the best horror movies out there.
Absolutely. Steve, do you have any remembrances of the first time you saw Scream or the legacy of the movie?
Well, I mean, I was 14 when it came out, so I'm an older boy myself. But I remember just being, I mean, I've always been a comedy fan first, horror fan second, mm-hmm. and really this movie is perfect if you love both of those genres. It's kind of like a parody of horror movies, but also straight up just a really good horror movie, and it holds up. I mean, I remember seeing it when I was young and thinking, this movie is perfect, it's amazing, this is a Oscar-winning masterpiece. Uh-huh. But yeah. It's like, really, I mean, now that you think back on the movie, I mean, we're 30 years ago? 20 years ago? You think about how, you know, there's no way it holds up, right? Like, there's no way a movie like this, I mean, it's very dated, there's a lot of 90s references, and everybody just... And in fact, rewatching it recently, it even has kind of like a Halloween like vibe, original Halloween yeah. vibe throughout. Mm. Just kind of like not just the score, but also just kind of the way it's shot and the pacing and the straight horror elements of it. But rewatching it now, 20 years later, it absolutely holds up. Yeah. It's like kind of cheesy in some ways, but it's such a unique, fun take on horror, and really just there's nothing else like it, really. Like, yeah. I mean, they've tried for sure, but it's so perfectly scary and funny, and it's still funny.
Yeah, there's
which
not
is
a
weird.
Single moment of filler in it right? either. It's like yeah. if I look back, and I do think it's a perfect movie. So if I look back and it's like, well, if I had to take one scene out, no, every single yeah. scene is so incredibly well done and memorable. Mm.
Do you remember how they marketed the movie at all? Like, or are you guys aware of like?
I remember.
I feel
yeah.
like they weren't sure to market it as like kind of a horror comedy, and instead it was kind of just like straight horror.
Yeah, I want to say it was straight horror, but it did have the elements. It's like, you know, what's your favorite scary movie?
Yeah, that's true.
That was how I remember it because and the bait and switch of Drew Barrymore mm-hmm. as. The lead oh, that perfect. You're going, the yeah. final girl.
Yeah.
That, because it was always the phone ringing, Drew Barrymore picking it up and talking about her favorite scary movies. And then you're like, oh, yeah, that's our final girl right there. Nope. And that's what I loved about it because it subverted your expectations.
Yeah.
Right as, I mean, 15 minutes in, you're like, wait a minute, nope, this has changed the game.
Yeah, I mean, it's the classic Janet Leigh Psycho
yep,
switch,
there it is.
Which was not on accident either.
Right.
It's, every little piece is such a love letter to the genre. Mm-hmm. And to your point about it holding up, I had a chance to screen the movie at the WGA earlier this year in January, actually, and Kevin Williamson was in attendance, and so mm-hmm. was Matthew Lillard. And but rewatching the film in a theater, I have to say, really with the exception of the fact that the sheriff says, what are you doing with a cellular, son? Or is that your cellular? You know, like he's calling the cell phone a cellular. Mm-hmm. But aside from that, I really feel like it's still very modern and very mm-hmm. sharp. And I wanted to also just mention one last thing, which was a hallmark of Wes Craven's throughout his whole career, but something that I think Kevin Williamson really got in the writing and Wes really got in the direction. And that was giving teenagers agency and respect. Mm. So, you know, it's really easy to look at all of these slasher movies and they're just expendables. Everyone, you know, Friday the 13th, you know, how much do you really care about the characters?
Yeah,
not
at all.
So much. And also, how much are they, how important are they character-wise to the plot? Like, not usually that important. But something that Scream did is it made these kids smart. Mm-hmm. And I know Kevin Williamson was criticized for that, like with Dawson's Creek, which came later, or like that they talk like 40-year-olds. But I mean, kids are funny, and teenagers aren't all assholes. You know yeah. what I'm saying? Like, I like that these are not vapid kids. They're kids that care about each other, some of them anyway. When I say agency, what I mean is the fact that this movie was not afraid to make these killers white, suburban, teenage boys who knew exactly what they were doing. And they were accountable. Billy Loomis is not, he sits there and he says, no, don't blame the movies. And I think that was a real important statement that Wes and Kevin Williamson were making. And just to, I mean, I know this is a little like heady and kind of dark, but Columbine came 2 years later, mm-hmm. right? And this still to this day, teenagers killing each other, you know, as a commentary on violence, is something we're still dealing with. And Scream tapped into it 2 years early. I just think, and I'm not saying there hadn't been teenage killers in horror movies before, but there was something different about these boys and their motivations. And I think it's really chilling. And that's what scares me.
Well, to the attacker in the school and having him run through the halls and like attack the lead character in the bathroom. Like, yeah, you're right. It kind of took the like being attacked in your school to a different level. Yeah.
No, I was gonna say you gave me chills talking about it, because I was like, oh my god, they were so ahead of their time, obviously, or able to look at society as it is then and predict, sadly, what could be the world we're living in now. And that's what's so poignant about the movie. And it's a horror movie. Yeah, I'm saying poignant. And terrifying about it as well, that's why it's going to stick around for the next 50 years, forever. It's going to stick around forever.
Yeah. We talk a lot sometimes about like movies that scare you when you're a kid, and then as you grow up, like what scares you about them kind of changes. Mm-hmm. And when I was a kid, I mean, yeah, like, you know, it was a slasher movie and there was Ghostface and all that stuff, but now that I'm an adult and I see it, like that's the part that really freaks me out the most. Any final thoughts on Scream?
I want really quick. What was the name of the actual Ghostface costume? It had like a weird name, like the costume itself was like Scare Daddy or something like that. Or like,
I don't know.
That's
was
a good piece of trivia like, that I do not know.
Well, like I remember looking at the actual name, because in the movie they pull out like the costume packaging and they're like, "This is what the killer is wearing," and it had the weirdest like actual name.
That I don't know.
And it made
know.
Me wonder
it's a good
where
trivia question.
Right? It kind of made me wonder.
Schmodown. Hashtag Schmodown.
Write it
oh,
down.
Boy.
It kind of made me wonder where Ghostface came from. I mean, obviously it's like, you know, it's a ghost face in a way, but. The original costume name is so bizarre and weird. I wonder why they didn't just call it that.
I mean, there's a whole backstory on the Ghostface mask and how
there's
they found
some
it
sort
and where
of,
they found it.
There's also all that controversy with the company that made it, because, you know, whatever happened with Scream the TV show and everybody's kind of disputing and blaming and all that nonsense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll get to the bottom of that mystery, but happy 20th birthday, Scream. Thank you for existing. Rest in peace, Wes. We love you, Kevin Williamson. Mark Riley, thank you for joining us for this short minute.
Thanks for having me. I had to talk about Scream. Thanks, Schnepp, for stepping out for a second.
Awesome.
Appreciate it.
Merry Christmas!
And moving on to our jump scares. So Perri and I were talking just a couple of yesterday. Actually.
Yes.
And we were talking about TV and just how there are some shows or are there some shows that are better if you watch them all in order, meaning, you know, you have every episode available, or are there some shows that actually benefit from being week to week? And I'm not talking about historically. I'm talking about now that we live in this like binge culture. And mark my words, you guys, the second The Exorcist goes on Netflix, people are going to, you know, whether it gets a second season or not, which is still undecided and we don't know, you know, people are going to lose their minds over it, but they're not watching it live. They're not watching it week to week. And same with Penny Dreadful. You know, Penny Dreadful was canceled this year, and I've mentioned it on the show before, but so many people have been tweeting at me saying, oh, I'm watching it on Netflix. It's so good. And I'm like, well, guys, you got to, how did it get canceled? And it's like, well, you didn't watch it.
Yep.
You didn't watch it when it was on. So, you know, streaming culture obviously has an impact on the way you watch things. This even came up when we were talking about Candle Cove.
Yeah.
Channel Zero. You know, I was watching it week to week and felt like, oh, maybe it could have been a movie. And then Perri watched it all in mostly one sitting. And she's like, really? I thought the pacing was great. So,
exactly.
Yeah, feel free to chime in, guys.
Well, first, I think it was Father Death.
That's it, Father Death.
Yeah, that is.
Like, that's what it's the
I was getting
though.
Really stressed about that. It was
Father
Death
for Christmas.
It was bothering me.
What?
But the reason that we started talking about it is because we were discussing Walking Dead, and I'm obviously doing the week-to-week recap show on Collider, so right now I am watching it week-to-week, but I went through a phase where I got on the Walking Dead train late, and I binged all of season one, and I loved it. I watched season two live, and I liked it. Then I didn't bother to watch seasons three, four, and five. But then I went back and binged them all, and I loved them all. And I know some people had issues with those seasons, and I really do think that because I binged all of those seasons is why I remember them so fondly. And I don't dislike watching Walking Dead week to week. I think because I had such a binge-heavy introduction to the series, I think that is kind of made me one of the more forgiving Walking Dead watchers out there, where I will just take everything I can get. But, you know, clearly that's a show that relies very heavily on cliffhangers, and I think cliffhangers can still be effective in binge-watching mode, where they could get frustrating when you are waiting however many months to watch who Negan hits in the head with a baseball bat. Then it could leave a bad taste in your mouth. So I think Walking Dead is definitely a show that is more suitable to binging than watching week to week. And then it got me thinking about other recap shows we do. And Game of Thrones, I find, is the exact opposite, especially as someone who is not a book reader. With Game of Thrones, if I binged that, there is no way I would ever retain all of that information. Even though the second a Game of Thrones episode is over, I want more. I also deeply value that 1 week's worth of digestion that I have to really wrap my head around what went down and, you know, consider where the characters are and where they're going, because I think I need that with that show.
I feel like if you're not watching shows like Walking Dead or Game of Thrones live, then you run the risk of being spoiled. And I think spoilers is the biggest reason to binge watch something if you're currently not watching it. I mean, if you're not watching a show like Game of Thrones live, maybe you don't care about spoilers, but it's like, really, it's the safest bet to get away from the spoilers, just binge the hell out of it. And in fact, really quick in regards to Walking Dead, I'm trucking through season 5 on Netflix right now, and I feel like the only problem with binge watching Walking Dead for me is that it just feels so repetitive. It's like attacked by walkers, dramatic scene with two people, wash, rinse, repeat. It's just the, and I feel like with the chance to kind of like give it a week, you get a moment to kind of like forget that that's really what the show is. It's like attacked by walkers, arguments between two people, dramatic moment, attacked by walkers. Like, it just, I feel like that's my thing. I mean, I'm still watching it and I still like it. There's something keeping me there. But yeah, I mean, I think just really the biggest issue with binging is just spoilers. I mean,
with Walking Dead, to your point, some seasons more so than others.
Yeah, that's true.
I think that series so far has gone through ebbs and flows, and it's like, I really love the series, but honestly, I took a break this season and just kind of like, I'm going to catch up because I watched, you know, the baseball bat episode, and I was like, you know, I'm just going to watch a bunch of other stuff because I'm behind on a million shows. So I was like, I'm going to binge that because that's how I've done a few of the other seasons, and I kind of enjoyed it. But I hear what you're saying. I mean, I think in the culture we live, like Westworld or Game of Thrones, I got to watch that on Sunday night. A, because a bunch of jerks are going to ruin it immediately on all forms of social media, even while it's on. So if you're even going to just like, oh, I'm going to update a picture of my cat, you're going to say, hey, guess who dies? just it'll just see somebody dies. F you.
I will say no one spoiled last weekend's Walking Dead, because I didn't do that show because I was at the Critics' Choice, and not a single person out there. And like, I was on social media the whole damn night.
Because of Westworld.
People are watching The Walking Dead right now.
People were spoiling Westworld. I watched Westworld, and that's what I was saying. Like, I had to
just like handed that joke to you.
I had to watch Westworld every week because anything that would happen, that would just show up immediately, just like Game of Thrones. So there are certain shows, especially the ones that are, I'd say, a little more restrictive. Like, you know, Walking Dead is on, like, everybody can watch it. Almost everybody. HBO, not as many, so the spoilers are a little heavier on those kind of shows. But to be honest with you, like when Netflix first started delivering DVDs, that's how I was sort of started binging, as like, you know, as opposed to just like, oh, these, I watch Star Trek every night at 5 o'clock. It's like, you know, or you would just buy all the DVDs and you could watch them whenever you want. But this kind of thing where you're like, I was catching up on Lost was the show that I was catching up on. It was, I think it was like season 3, and I hadn't watched one episode. And it was like, yeah, let's check it out. And we just got sucked into it. So Holly and I would spend like, we'd watch like 5 episodes a night. We're like, oh my God, Lost is so amazing. And I think people complained about season 3. They're like, season 3 fucking sucked. And I was
That was your season.
That was, well, I don't know if
that's
it was
where
my,
you started.
I backed up, watched all of through season 1, 2, and 3, and then started watching 4 in real time.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, so we smoked through season 3, and I wasn't bored at all. And I think what happened is because of those waits
per week.
Yeah.
People were like, well, how come they didn't follow Skimby Scum or Ribbleborb or whatever their names were? And instead it was like, this one's about Flippo and they die at the end. You're like, well, who cares about Flippo? It's like, but if you're watching them consecutively, you know, oh, that's just a one-off. It doesn't matter. But if you have to wait a whole week and then you get a kind of an episode that doesn't have your character in it, then you have to wait another week.
Yeah, Lost was the worst for that, watching live, because you were like, what's going to happen? Like, and then they'd have a whole episode about, like, Rose and Bernard, the kind of ancillary characters, and then you're like, but there's things happening in the hatch! I don't care about these characters!
That's exactly why I think Walking Dead of all shows is suitable, especially that, what season was the Journey to Terminus? Was that four or
five?
I think that one in particular I liked so much because I was binging and I could see where everybody was all at once.
Right. I guess that's true. Yeah. I could agree with that.
Well, all right. Keep watching your TVs. There's no...
I'm
shutting you down because we have Twitter questions. But no, I mean, honestly, like, it is really interesting. I was just thinking back to True Detective. I just rewatched True Detective season one.
Which is awesome.
Which is super awesome. And, boy, it's a lot to consume in a day. Like, I rewatched the first four or five episodes, and by the time I got to the fifth episode, I was like, God, I need a break.
Exhausted.
And that is a show, I think, really, that benefited from being week to week, whereas I felt the same way, to use the Walking Dead comparison as well, with that show in particular. So it's interesting, but, you know, gosh, the way people consume and when they consume is all so personalized. Mm-hmm. I think that's the thing that we've learned today.
And at least we have the option, too. Like, you, most of the time, you have the option.
Yes,
so.
You do, in theory, until your show gets canceled because nobody watches it.
That's right. True. Then you can just binge watch a show that's canceled and feel sad when you get to the end of it.
And wonder why there's not more of it.
I know.
Yeah, but bummer. Anyway.
It's like bummer. A vicious cycle.
It sure is, Perri.
Wah, life is hard.
Everyone, get on your cellular and call in. We want the show back.
All right, let's move on to our Twitter questions. Ho, ho, ho. They're all Christmas-themed and Krampus-themed.
Would you call me Clark?
You heard me.
Leave her alone.
We've got two, yeah. Way to tie it back to Scream, Perri. All right, so we've got two here today. The first one is Mr. Film Art, and he asks, oh, Ray, I love this graphic. Thanks for making it Christmassy.
Beautiful.
Do you consider The Nightmare Before Christmas a Halloween movie or a Christmas movie? This is the age-old debate, I tell ya. I know that I think I don't feel passionately about one or the other, to be honest, because I don't like A Nightmare Before Christmas. Yeah,
you've
sorry.
Said this before.
I know.
I would have had a bigger reaction if I hadn't heard it before.
Well,
but
I feel like, gosh, and if we weren't running low on time, I would tell you exactly why, but it doesn't matter.
We're talking about it afterwards.
One day, one day.
Okay,
we can make that a debate segment.
Yes, oh, we do. Why doesn't Clarke?
It's called Don't Hate Me Because I'm Wrong. That's what the debate. The debate. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh boy, take your Christmas cheer and shove it, Schnepp. Okay, no, but where do we stand on this, guys? I think that A Nightmare Before Christmas is 100% a Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm. I've got a strong opinion on this. I think Nightmare Before Christmas is uniquely both. Mm-hmm. I think it's a Christmas movie and a Halloween movie. Mm-hmm. And I don't know any other movie like that. I really think it is just, that's what it is.
Can I even sandwich in Thanksgiving? I would say it's Halloween,
maybe
Thanksgiving,
a little bit.
And Christmas. Okay. It just, I think they were really smart. They covered all their bases. I mean, we were talking about, is Die Hard a Christmas movie? Yes and no, but it's like, this is inherently both. So,
yeah.
I mean, there really is. But you could favor one over the other. It depends on which holiday you like more and which, you know, like, oh, I watch Nightmare Before Christmas all the time on Halloween because you like Halloween more. So, I mean, I don't know. I agree with you. I think it's both.
I agree with both of you. I think it's both. And I watch it on Halloween and I watch it on Christmas. And the reason it is both a Halloween and a Christmas movie is because it celebrates both holidays at the same time.
And loves them both.
That's what it's about. It's about the character's journey to embrace another holiday while still having bits and pieces of his own kind of infuse that celebration and making this really warped holiday out of it. I love this movie to death, if you couldn't tell.
Yeah, I certainly do as well.
And I tried to name a pet after a character in this movie. That's what I do when
Which
I love
character?
Me. This is a funny story that I'll make really quick, I swear. So my parents got a white dachshund, and I tried to name it Zero.
Oh,
and then in the Jewish tradition, if a family member dies, then you name a child after it. So after we name this dog Zero, we get a call from my grandmother, whose name is Zena and loves horror movies. And she's like, you will not name that dog Zero. You change it now. So now that dog is named Wally.
Aww.
So there you go.
But well, in spirit, it's named Zero.
Exactly. But you know his but his Hebrew name is
Don't
Zero.
Don't tell Nana that.
Well, actually, director Henry Selick has proclaimed that he believes The Nightmare Before Christmas is a Halloween movie.
He's wrong!
When I said it was a Christmas movie earlier, I might actually think it's... I don't know what I think, to be honest. I can clearly care less.
It's a toss-up.
Yeah, so go debate amongst yourself, nerds. Okay, and finally, Christmas nerds. Austin Server asks, what are some good horror Christmas flicks? Great question. And of course, it's that time of year. And we were talking about it earlier. There aren't really any Hanukkah
There
no.
should
movies.
Be.
But What's the Hanukkah Goblin?
Yeah, Herschel and the Hanukkah Goblins. Look it up
right.
if you were a 90s kid.
Not
you know
a movie,
what I'm talking
book,
about.
Though,
yeah, exactly. You got to read it. It's a picture book, so come on, guys. I'm going to start. I said it, and I still feel strongly about it, and James Wan confirmed it, The Conjuring 2. When we saw The Conjuring 2 this summer, I was like, why didn't they put this out at Christmas? This is like totally right. a cool, mm. weird, creepy Christmas mm-hmm. movie. So that's my pick.
Okay, I'm sorry, Schnepp. Krampus.
Yeah, I know.
I do. I really like Krampus. I don't like it as much as I like
Schnepp.
Trick or Treat, but
I agree.
I'm a big fan of that movie. I'm a big fan of that legend, and I especially love the third act in that movie and what
really?
He does. Yeah, I like what he does with creatures. I like where he ends it. No spoilers here, but I am a pretty big fan of Krampus.
I like the practical.
Thanks.
I like the practical effects.
Yeah.
I love that. I love the Krampus lore, but I feel like they didn't do it justice. Everyone was like, "It's like Gremlins."
I'll,
I was like, "No,
I'll
it's
give
not."
You yeah. that. I think
Gremlins is
I think
actually
they could
really
have
good.
Gone in a better direction
like
with it
with Krampus,
in
right?
many respects.
Yeah.
I don't think they do the legend justice, but I still like the movie he came out with,
it
and
didn't
I still
know if
enjoy
it.
It
wanted to be a horror movie or comedy, and it was neither.
Yeah,
agreed.
And then it got like confused, like yeah. on a very like emotional level, because you're like, am I supposed to laugh at this?
Yeah.
They're gonna throw a kid into hell right now. Like that's crazy.
Hilarious, said the Krampus.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I hope he does an awesome Godzilla movie, and I love Trick or Treat. So, but
there
you know what,
yeah.
Krampus sucked. So. My pick is
coming.
Rare Exports, which is
yes.
an amazing
oh, yeah.
Schnepp
is always
good call. Good
yeah,
call.
It's a really fun film. Check it out. It's a foreign film. You're gonna have to read some subtitles, but it's worth it for the end.
If you're reading the book about the Jew goblins, then you can read the
yeah.
one about
check it out. It's just English subtitles, and it's about like a bunch of creepy Santa Clauses, or are they elves?
Well, guys, we're missing a huge one, but go ahead. What, do you have any?
Gremlins!
Okay, well,
Gremlins.
That wasn't the one I was going to say, but that's
oh.
also a huge
Gremlins
one.
Is my go-to Christmas movie.
Love it.
Because I'm a horror boy, and I love mm-hmm. Joe Dante, and I love puppets,
yeah.
and I love Chris Columbus, and I love Jerry Goldsmith, and I love, it just it goes on and on.
Those are great things to love. Mm. Well, I've got to throw out Black Christmas, you guys.
Yeah,
yeah.
Of course.
Okay,
of course.
Okay.
Bob Clark's masterpiece. Bob mm-hmm. Clark really likes Christmas, huh? Christmas
he does.
Story, and oh, RIP, Bob Clark. But yes, I love Black Christmas, and I came to that one much later in my horror life. But it, you know what? Okay, we're going long, but you know what? It's extra Christmas cheer for you kids. the first time I saw Black Christmas, because you know this is a movie that was came out in the 70s, I think,
yes.
and I had never seen it growing up, and I came to it as an adult. Like I graduated college, I'm out of college, I'm a grown up, and I rented Black Christmas and I watched it, and it actually creeped me out. It was disturbing, and the things that man says on the phone are really upsetting and scary. And so I was like, damn, for a slasher movie from the 70s, because y'all know how I feel about slasher movies, I don't like them, but for a slasher movie from the 70s to still creep me mm-hmm. out and to still be socially relevant and have, I mean, I love Black Christmas.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. creepy. Definitely
super
check it out.
It's a good one, yeah.
Anyone, any last call for Christmas movies or holiday
nothing.
Movies? Is there a scary New Year's Evil? There's, hmm. you know.
I mean, I like the Tim and Eric Krimbus special.
That's
I think that's
right.
great. I think All I like
right.
that a lot.
It's technically a horror.
Yeah,
comic.
Technically yeah. a horror because it's terrifying. A lot of terrifying
nope.
stuff in it.
Nope. Also, fun fact, one Christmas a couple of years ago, my mom, my brother, and I gathered around the tree on Christmas morning, and we watched Drag Me to Hell, and it was awesome.
Yeah. Oh,
wonderful.
We love
family.
To watch scary
family
movies. Yeah. Because that is a tradition. That used to be a Christmas tradition to tell ghost stories. So now we just, like historically, that's where Christmas Carol comes from. And so, yeah, so it's kind of fun to continue that with our scary movies. All right. Anyway, that concludes this lesson of Christmas history. Thank you guys so much for watching. We'll say our quick goodbyes. Perri, where can they find you?
You guys can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff. Of course, on Collider Nightmares every Wednesday morning. There's also Movie Talk on Friday morning. There's Mailbag on Saturday, Best of the Week on Saturday. All that good stuff. Go watch it and have a great holiday, everyone.
Wonderful. And Mr. Jon Schnepp?
You can find me celebrating Crimbus, Crombus, Scrimulon, Scramble Scrimp, and all the other Fringer Kringer Krungs. And I'll see you guys in 2017. You can find me on Twitter, Instagram at Fromble Frank and Scrimble Scrum and Jon Schnepp. Nightmares.
Love it. And finally, to our special guest, Mr. Steve Zaragoza. Hey. Where can they find you?
Thank you. You guys are great. You can find me on Twitter at Steve Zaragoza. I actually have some podcasts I'd like to plug. From the HeadGum Network. One of them is called Dynamic Banter. It's me and Mike Falzone, fellow comedian and SourceFed host. We just talk about whatever. And we have a Lost recap, like rewatch podcast called It Feels Like the First Time, and it's real weird. We take clips from the show and we play them over and over again in nightmarish ways. It's very great. It's fun. It's good stuff.
I love it. That's fabulous. And I will be tuning in for sure.
Please do.
I will.
And did you watch Lost? Did you guys all watch
Lost? No, I didn't actually, and so I feel like I need to listen to your show.
I watched
all
of it.
Well, I would love to have you all on at some point, including you who's never seen
it.
I'll be a noob. Throw you into season 3.
You've never seen any Lost? Fun fact,
let me do season 4. I mean 5.
Oh, hell yeah. You're in, baby.
The only episodes of Lost I've ever seen, premiere and finale.
Wow. Interesting.
You're missing so much in the middle.
So much.
Was it up for
so many confusing loose ends.
Yeah.
What do the numbers mean inside the hatch? What is the snow beast? It's a polar bear. No, it's not.
We're off the rails. Too much eggnog for us. You can find me at Clarke Wolfe. Clarke with an E. Wolf with an E. Happy Hanukkah. Merry Christmas. Happy Kwanzaa. Well, not saying Happy New Year yet because we are going to be back next week. We're not going anywhere, you guys. You're not going to get rid of us. So thank you so much for watching. Happy holidays, and we will see you in your nightmares.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.